Hi everyone, thank you for having me. I'm really honored to be here as one of the speakers in the Polyglot International Conference. Just a little survey, siapa yang bisa bahasa Indonesia? Wow. Who speak Indonesian? That's kind of like, that was the questions. But, well, anyway, it's not about Indonesian language per se, but this is about how to start your own polyglot community. It's about community building, so you can actually apply this for other community that you want to have. And basically, the concept of this presentation is that we will have a video, we have pictures, we will have audience participation in the end, and then the slide is only a pointer, so I will talk a lot more than what we have on the slide. And then, so, yeah, and in the end, in the Q&A, for each questions, I will give you one of these. This is Indonesian, talk to me in Deutsch. Talk to me in Italiano. Talk to me in Korean. Talk to me in Russian, talk to me in Espanol, and talk to me in Arabic and Chinese Mandarins, Mandarin Chinese, right? So you just need to say your name and then which language you want, and I will take a note and we'll distribute after the presentation. And just a disclaimer, we want you to be our marketing material, so there is no freelance, so I will take a photos and then share it to the Polyglot Indonesia community. So we know that there is a Polyglot community around the world that recognize us, basically. So having said that, we'll start with the presentations, and we'll have all of the questions after the presentation finish. So if you have questions, please just take a note. And this presentation is an overview because I want to address your specific question related to your culture, your geographical location. So I will have more time for a Q&A. Right. So let's start. So yeah, Polyglotindonesia, this is our X banner that we have in every presentation, workshop, or in any conference. Basically, well, you don't have to read this. It is like I put it here. And do we have pointer? Oh, we do have pointer. No? Doesn't work? Yeah. Okay. So this is me, Arradi Nur Rizal. Yes, with the apostrophe is breaking a lot of computer system at the moment. So usually I don't have this. Even in my passport, I don't have the apostrophe. It's a transliteration from Arabic, so that's why we have. I have this apostrophe, and this is our website polyglotindonesia.org. We have the fan page Polyglotindonesia groups, Polyglotindonesia groups in Facebook, and then Twitter Polyglot Indo, Instagram Polyglotindonesia, and YouTube Polyglot Indonesia. This is all of our social media, right? So you can visit and then follow us, so we know we have more followers. And please do see our videos, Instagram posts, and other stuff. Yes, so who am I? I'm this guy. this is my email if you want to contact me. It is rizal@polyglotindonesia.org. I'm Indonesian, originally from Indonesia, but my first mother language is not Indonesian. My mother language is Javanese. My second language is actually Indonesian. I had to learn it in school. And my third language is Spanish, actually. And then after that, English. And then German. And now I'm speaking Swedish because I'm living in Sweden, so I have to speak Swedish somehow. Yeah. My background is actually not in linguistic per se. I'm by train, I'm electrical engineer and then computer scientist. Take a master's degree in management and entrepreneurship. I took that, and now, right now I'm working for Lund University in Sweden, as so I'm helping them building new department, and my last project is search engine. We do a lot of NLP, natural language processing, so how to tell the computer to understand the, in Swedish it's called sama sata ord, so it's basically the combined word, so how to make sure that music heuristic, like music law, is not actually the same word, but it's two different words. So that's how you teach the computer how to differentiate between, if you search for music heuristics, you get the result from music heuristic and music heuristic. So that's what they want, something like that. That's my little project that I'm working on in the university. And then, this is my life. I've been living and then educated in these places. Well, I took this from my Facebook, so I just crop it out. This is actually my photos that has been uploaded to Facebook. So as you can see, I've been brown, I guess. I think it's enough about me. And if you see this, it means a video. So be excited that, oh yeah, video or something like that. So I will play our video from 2013. I we started in 2013, actually 1 year before, but we registered as a non-profit organization in 2013. We are actually a legal entity in Indonesia. So we have organization number and so on and so forth. So this is the, I hope there is a sound here. No, back, go back.
Hello, I'm Gabriel Zahir Wisiranto.
Yes, I'm Fremita.
Me llamo Ira Julianti Purnomo.
Hello, servus. My name is Mira.
Assalamualaikum.
Konnichiwa.
Nama saya Fokus Mara dari Jepang.
Mio nome è Fabi, e sono da Indonesia.
Nama saya Simon.
Hello, nama saya Sisil.
Mira, itu teman-teman di belakang kok pada ngomong ya, tapi ngomong A, aku ngomong B, mereka lagi ngomong
sih. Ternyata mereka itu bisa belajar bahasa asing, ini dia.
Di era globalisasi seperti sekarang ini, memiliki keahlian dan pendidikan tinggi saja tidaklah cukup.
Ah, 처음에는 저 그 외국에 가고 싶어서 그리고 외국어는 공부하게 됐어요. 그렇기 때문에 저는 그 외국어 공부하고 나서 그 외국에 가는 기회가 생겼어요. 그래서 저 그 외국에 가게 됐어요. 私は子供の時 日本語 勉強 することを 始めました. その時は 日本語の 日本の 文化は 日本の 漫画 好き的斯卡拉，日本語勉強しました。我学过了那个几个国家的文字，现在呢，我会说大概三个国家的文字，英文、中文和韩国语。别的语言呢，我觉得是，会说一点吧。现在 mulai belajar bahasa sejak kuliah。 Pada waktu itu saya tergabung dengan mahasiswa komunitas bahasa Inggris. Dari situ saya mulai belajar bahasa-bahasa asing.
Biasa, kita hari ini kedatangan tamu spesial sekali,
yes.
Yaitu anggota dari Polyglot Indonesia.
Thank you.
biar tidak lupa, saya di Facebook semua teman Indonesia aja. Jarang yang ngomong sama orang Italia karena sibuk ngomong sama teman. Biar nggak lupa bahasa Indonesia.
You're still listening to Metropolitan International Community Service. And listeners, as I promised you before, now I have special guests. And here they are, they're from Polyglot Indonesia.
Radio Juranya Musik Indonesia. Seru banget listeners ya, ngobrol sama anak-anak Polyglot.
Anak-anak Polyglot ada Adi, ada Edit, ada Tio, listeners, ada Chandra dan juga ada Tiar di sini listeners ya. Dan mereka ini sudah dibentuk dari mulai Februari 2013 kemarin.
Presentation. Oh, thank you, thank you. Because as you can see, we had a lot of activities. So currently, this is Indonesia. Indonesia, we have 34 provinces. We have around 250 million people, and we have around more than 700 languages. So languages means that we have different alphabets in certain region. It's not like dialects, but it's actually a language. For instance, I'm from Java. Island, so Java Island is around here, and here people speaks around more than 10 languages, right? And if I want to go to Bandung, I have to speak Indonesian because they don't speak Javanese, which is my mother tongue. And yeah, we as a Polyglot Indonesia, what is actually Polyglot Indonesia as a community? So Polyglot Indonesia is not just about language community. We have a vision that we want to inspire people, especially the youth generation, in the area of language proficiency and cultural awareness. So you will see that our activity is not only language related, but also cultural related. And for the past 3 years, the last scene, we had a declaration of our nonprofit organizations in the previous video. And for the last 3 years, we have more than 1,000 activities, including meetups, other stuff. And at the moment, we have around 100 plus coordinators around Indonesia. We are running in 10 different cities, and we have trial in some cities as well. And at the moment, we have around 17,000 members. So that's us. And then, another video. This is a lot shorter than before, so no worries. It's not like, it's not me buying time, so there's no worries.
Oh, no, sorry.
Yeah, listen to the song. This is our jingle, actually. We create our own jingle. So you can hear what we actually sing. Yeah, okay. This guy is our former Minister of Education, so he is giving encouragement to all of the Polyglot Indonesia members. And yeah, his speech is really long and in Indonesian, so I'm not going to play it. So next is, this is our coverage. We have international, we have a CNN as well at us. And yeah, this is the most of we have around more than 100 coverage local and international media. That's all. Yeah, that's all for the not the presentation, but the showing off of Polyglot Indonesia. Now, what is the history actually? How did it begin? So basically, the story was, I was traveling in Hanoi, and then I met an elderly woman, and then she tried to speak to me in 4 different languages, in the language that I've learned. And in that time, I was so lazy, so I didn't actually speak the language anymore, so, you know. And then I realized that, it's a bit disappointed that I have learned this a lot of languages, but I don't maintain it. And then when I come back to the country that I was living, it was in UK, in Scotland, actually. Then I tried to find different, videos, like material from YouTube. And then I stumbled upon a video says that hyperpolyglot speaking 16 languages. Maybe you know that video, is it? So then I'm thinking to myself, like, why there's only foreigners doing this video? Why there's no Indonesians? Like, at least we are trilingual, because first we have to speak our mother local language. Second, we have to learn our national language, which is Indonesian. And then we have to learn international language, which is like usually English, right? And then there's a lot of people that studying in Germany, they speak German. So at least we have like minimum trilingual. So why there's no video? And then, I searched, I found one guy he was showing that he could able to converse in 13 languages, and he's Indonesian. His name is Krishna, or some people recognize him as Lorenzo. Jan knows about him. He talked with Jan in Seoul. He is currently in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. So he's in Hong Kong, actually. That's actually the guy who spoke Chinese, Japanese, Korean, but Indonesia. He speaks other European language, but we didn't have time to show all of his languages that he can speak of. Then, I moved to Sweden, and I want to go back to Indonesia at some point. And I need a place in Indonesia where I can go and speak multiple languages in the same place. So Indonesia, if you want to speak Deutsch, you should usually go to Goethe Institute. They have a conversation class there. If you want to speak Spanish, you go to Cervantes, right? And then if you want to speak Italian, you go to ECE or EFI for French language. And usually they have a conversation class, and it's a regular, you know, twice a week, once a week, and then you have to pay. And I'm pretty much, well, I want to pay, but I don't have a commitment. I don't have financial commitment, and I don't have time commitment. I just want to go. If I want to go this week, I can go. If I want to go like next month, I can go. But I don't have to go there every time because I don't have the commitment in time and in money as well. So in Sweden, we have this language cafe. It's where you go and then you just go to one place. There is a Spanish table, there is an Italian table, there is a Russian table, there is a German table. So you can sit 15 minutes talking about something in French and then move to other table and then speak Spanish for another 15 minutes. I want to have that. So Indonesia, I tried to find one and I didn't know where to find. And another thing is, when I come back from Argentina, I used to not study. I did exchange student. I went to Argentina, and then when I went back to my hometown, Semarang. Semarang is not capital city; it's small town. Well, it's small town for Indonesian town, but there's 2 million people in it, so probably not small. So I consider it like a small town. But so. Yeah, I didn't know where to go to find someone who can converse with me in Spanish. I don't want to learn Spanish. I know Spanish. Well, I knew Spanish. Probably I don't know. But I knew Spanish, and I just want to talk about things, right, with them. I don't want to learn Spanish. But I didn't have that medium, or I don't have that place to go. And if you want something and you do not find it, there is two options for you, right? First, wait until somebody else make it for you, or the second option is make it yourself, right? Then I choose the second route, which is make it myself, because why not? Why not make it myself? Because I need one, right? So yeah, so the beginning was I need an affordable place in Indonesia where I can practice my languages without being judged. The being judged is important as well, because in Indonesia, even in Semarang, my hometown, the lingua franca is Javanese. And you speak Indonesian, they will say, why do you speak Indonesian to us? I mean, this is weird, right? And then in Jakarta, and you try to speak English, it's like, it seems to be like arrogant or like, what is it like? Arrogant and then greedy or whatever. I don't know why, but they say, you just come back from Italy and suddenly you speak only Italian. Or you just come back from Germany and there's some words that you say in German. Like for instance, after living in Germany, Asso and Egal is quite, you know, you say it without thinking, right? So that kind of things. That's another part that is important without being judged. That's important as well. So we can have the same community where you can freely speak to each other. I mean, yesterday I went out with some polyglot attendees in a restaurant. I saw like the energy and then the interaction between people. Like they just met, but they, after like 15 minutes, one guy trying to explain Mandarin in French, even though he's not French, they suddenly became like BFF already, like best friend forever. That kind of, I was thinking like, why don't we have that everywhere in the world? Why not have that everywhere in the world? Why not just scale that, replicate that, clone that to any other city? So you don't have to go to Polyglot Conference to have that energy, to have that passion, to have that, you know, enthusiasm. Yeah. So yeah, this is one way to do it. There's other way. I'm not claiming it's the best way, but I hope the next slide will be useful for you. Yeah, this is our target audience. So yesterday I was talking with people, and then we have specific target audience. It's categorized into three category, and each one category for two type of people. First, this category is the returnees. Returnees is like ex-overseas. It's for people who has been studying abroad or living abroad for whatever reason, and they came back to Indonesia, and they want to practice their non-mainstream language. Like, for instance, they went to Russia. Nobody speak Russian in Indonesia. Like, where do you find Russian-speaking people in Indonesia, right? You probably go to a Russian embassy, but they probably not going to, well, they probably cannot help you with Indonesian who speak Russian, right? So, and then, other maybe mainstream European language, but not so mainstream Indonesia, like French, Italian, Spanish. It's really hard to find. Well, there is no place to go to find, like, hey, I speak Spanish, I want to meet someone who speaks Spanish as well. There's no place. And we have a language enthusiast as well. The person who have really high passion in language learning. And then the second one is aspiring travelers and language learners. It's usually for people who how to say it in Bavarian accent, something like that. So you learn Deutsch in Guten Institute, and then you land in Munich, they don't speak Hochdeutsch, that's for sure. And the Berliner also have their own accent, so or dialect. So that kind of things they want to, how to blend into the culture, you have to learn the slangs. And language learners as well, like so people who want to learn language, like, you know, I want to try Russian for 1 month. Let's see what happens. Am I going to like it? They don't have financial commitment to go to the Russian institute, language institute, for instance. They just want to try with other people that have been learning it. So, yeah. And then the third one is foreigners and Indonesian diaspora. Foreigners is for expats that coming to Indonesia, and then they want to speak Indonesian. The problem with foreigners trying to learn Indonesia in Indonesia is Indonesians want to speak English with them. So one of my friends complained, how can I study or practice Indonesian? You're always speaking English to me, right? So that's one issue that need to be addressed. And also Indonesian diaspora. Indonesian diaspora is people who like Indonesian culture, but they are not Indonesian, or they were Indonesian, but they changed their citizen to other citizenship. So yeah, so this is our three main target audience. This is the people that will benefit, from our activity. And then this is our organizational structure. So we have a function here around chapters. Chapter is chapter Jakarta, it's like chapter Thessaloniki, chapter Athens, so we have different chapters. And we go with the federal type of governmental, so each chapter can do whatever they want. They have coordinators, they have regional coordinators, and this function is actually to support the activity in the chapters. So we go from bottom up, not top down. So yeah, so this is the function. We have social media, creative, website, smart resource development, contributor membership, corporation outreach, cooperation and outreach, chapter development, and this is secretary director of operation, executive director, and chairman. And this is me, currently. Just to want to point out. So, but yeah, I'm not going to talk about this further. If you want to have, if you have a question, you can ask me also. And this is our activities. This is the poster that we have. This is in Yogyakarta. We have this poster. We share it in social media. And then this is in Surabaya, in Rumah Bahasa in Surabaya. Rumah Bahasa is a language house in Surabaya. We have language house. It's actually not created by us, but created by the government of the city government of Surabaya, and we volunteer to be a teacher there in the Rumah Bahasa. So we teach middle and lower income people to prepare for the ASEAN free trade. So we teach the parking guy to at least he knows passive English. We teach the the lady that doing that selling stuff in the street. So that kind of activity that we have. And we have several languages there. If you go to Surabaya, just please visit this place, call them, and then say that I want to visit. They will welcome you really warm-heartedly. Yeah, and this is another activities, another type of activities. We have a short film screening and discussion session. And this part is a French movie. Is it? Yeah, I don't actually know, but let's say we have Lee, so it must be French. So, and then we have a sing-along with us type of activities. This is from Aceh, this is from Jakarta, no? From Jakarta. Yeah, from Yogyakarta, sorry, from Yogyakarta. And this is other activities, we have we have a Jakarta Book Fiesta, we kind of like, we help them. This is in Jakarta. We have movie screening in Aceh, we have, this is the Rumah Bahasa in Surabaya. This is how we kind of like teach. And this is, we volunteer, we team up with organization to help bridge between the player. This is actually International Street Soccer Championship. So this year is in Indonesia. So the Polyglot Indonesia helps them to, you know, translate and then interpret their interaction there. And then we have a theme party, and then we have some kind of a talk show, and we have a language contest here as well. And other activities, as I said before, we are not only doing language related, but also culture related. We send people to UNOC, United Nations Alliance for Civilizations. We did it in Baku, in Azerbaijan, and then also in Bali. This is the executive director of Polyglot Indonesia, is Mira. This is one of our activities, sending people to a conference. And yeah, and then another things that I want to highlight, each coordinator have their own achievements. This is one of the coordinators, is a former regional coordinator from chapter Semarang. So he won Best Paper Prize, Best Presentation Prize, Indonesian Special Scholar in the Third Asian Future Conference with research paper titled Fundamental Concept and Perception of University Students in Apprehending the Relation Between Global and Local Languages. Okay, long title, okay. But usually paper does have long titles. So yeah, this is one of his achievements. So we also supporting that. And we also have collaboration activities with other organizations. This is storytelling workshop with Toastmaster. Maybe you know, maybe you have that in your own country. And we have RC Talk with Rotary Club. So kind of like Rotary Club, but it's more for young people. And then, another video. Yay. So I can think.
Who is he? He's a thug that hanging around my neighborhood. He looks so scary. I don't even know what he's doing here. Oh my god. Where is it?
I know this place. It's a shop of visually impaired people.
Yeah, sorry guys, I will tell you story.
Oh my god! He reads for them?
Yeah,
Wow.
That was a video that we submit for ASEAN video contest in youth volunteerism. It's still, they are still selecting. I hope we will win. And how do we do it? So the way we do it is actually only four parts. First, concept, share, connect, and feedback. So concept means create topics and secure venue. There's several ways to secure venue. You can talk to me if you want to have it in detail. Share, invite audience through social media. We use only social media, actually, to share and then invite people. Connect, engage audience during the activities. The engagement is important to make sure that we understand what they need and they feel home in the event. And then they will tell their friends about this about the activities and they will come back with their friends. So that's what we want. And then feedback is listen to the audience to improve their negative activity. Usually we send a feedback form to each participant so we know what they like and why, and what they don't like and why they don't like it, so we can improve it in the next activities. And then this is our tools, our internal tools. We have collaboration system, communication system, storage system. So this is Google Doc, Trello, WhatsApp, Skype, Line, and Telegram. The majority of communication, we use WhatsApp. And this is our storage system. We use Google Drive to store all of our documents and assets. And we use Dropbox and SkyDrive for a backup. The Trello is collaboration for project management. So we know who do what at what time in which you know, is it in progress, is it done, or you need more requirement, or what kind of stuff. So we use Trello for that. And on the Trello, each task has deadlines and then, you know, documentation. So you can track what happened in the organization without actually asking one of, like each of our members, our contributors. And this is our marketing tools. We have Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram mainly. For multimedia, we have YouTube and SoundCloud. SoundCloud is mainly used if, for instance, VL over there is making an article and then about how to pronounce Indonesian word correctly. He record the sound and put it on SoundCloud. And for web and mail, we use Drupal for our main platform for website, and Outlook for the contact at polyglot.org. So the mail system is not hosted in the same system. And we use MailChimp, and we are going to use MailChimp for a newsletter, you know this. And then we have lesson learned. Quality over quantity means that it's better to have a high quality conversation rather than a lot of people having the conversations. So it's better to have like 3 or 4 or 5 in one table instead of 10, but the 5 having like really passionate, intimate conversation, because we tried. This was like 200 people came, and then it was a chaos because nobody actually can talk to each other. So it's better to have a really nice quality conversation. So what we have is we split it into tables. And usually if you have people that speak a lot of, for instance, there is an English table and then there are a lot of people there, you can split it based on the language level. So the beginner speak with the beginner, and then the, you know, the advanced, the C1 people speak with the C1 and the C2 people. And balancing knowledge and fun, this one based on our feedback as well, we have to balance between the fun activity and then knowledge sharing. So you have to make sure that you don't waste people time to come the activity and you get nothing other than just having fun. You need to get, you know, other things as well. And participant tracking, so you have to track participant. So you have to track participant. Participant, so you know where is in the event. Who is in the event? Because you don't want outside people coming, and then you know, because the outside people can distract, and then you know, destroy the intimate conversations. And then set your brand as early as possible. So basically, you want to have like a one logo or one brand saying that this is us from in the beginning, because it's hard to change it in the middle. And some tips: start small, start soon. So it's better to start 5 people. When I started, I only thought about like 5 people will come, but it was 20. But 20 is good enough. And start soon. I mean, you have to start soon as possible. Run regular activities. Set culture from the beginning. It means that you have to decide what kind of topic, what kind of behavior in the group. So, for instance, no political or racial discussion, or that kind of stuff. And then you have to set the tone that this is our culture and this is how we do the things. Keep participants motivated. This is important, so they don't feel down. They don't get bored. And then the toxic part is they get bored and then they tell other people that this activity is boring. So they, you know, they is preventing people to come. Yes, this is last video, and sorry. It's only yes.
Hello, greetings! Greetings from Polyglot Indonesia! Esta is so poly!
Polyglot Indonesia,
speak up!
Yes, so we have a greetings from Polyglot Indonesia, and as a polite human being, if somebody say something to you, like say greetings, it's better to, you know, say something back to them, right? So I'm going to record you saying terima kasih. So you just need to read this. This is Indonesian. Thank you, our friends in Polyglot Indonesia. So you read it. Terima kasih teman-teman Polyglot Indonesia. So it's like reading German or Spanish alphabet. It's really easy. And this is actually our alphabet, so you don't have to read the weird word. So can we have the light on? Lights on? Yes. When you ready, say it together. 1, 2, 3. Yeah. Wow. You can just contact me for if you want to have a question about Polyglot Indonesia after the presentation, or you can contact Phil if you have question about Indonesia. Phil is the guy who have Indonesia as a yeah. So yeah, questions, please.
So going back to your original question, how can I get language practice in Indonesia where I'm not judged? I had the same question when I moved to Tbilisi, Georgia, and I created the Language Exchange Club Tbilisi. Mm. We have an entirely horizontal structure with no management, and people get together and they speak different languages on different nights of the week. So my question is, why did you choose such a management-intensive form of creating this opportunity?
Oh, that's a really good question. So the question was why we have this structure, basically, right? So the structure is actually flat. It's actually, you see it from the top, and the center of the management is the chapters. So the chapters can do whatever they want, basically, within the same rules that we have. The rules is basically our branding strategy, our funding, and our stuff. The reason is because we want to be not only Polyglot community, but beyond that. Our vision runs for 5 and then 10 years from now. Like, for instance, we want to, you know, archive all of the 700 endangered languages in Indonesia, both voice and then, you know, written. To do that, we need a sponsor. To have a sponsor, you need to create a proposal, right? And then the sponsor need to have a person in Indonesia who can contact them directly, right? So they don't want to, if we do it voluntarily, you do it like if you have time, something like that. The sponsor doesn't want that. Plus, when we do that, to have a sponsor from other legal entity, you need to be a legal entity as well. So that's why we need the management. We need the legal and the organization number. We need the bank account, and we even have a UPIC, participant identification code. So if someone here want to sponsor us, we have the legal binding already. So, so yeah, that's actually the reason. We just don't want to only have language fund, but also what kind of things that we can help or contribute to Indonesia with us being language passionate though, or like language enthusiast. That's kind of the reason why we have this structure, but we is not top down. It means like the function around it is just how to have balancing. You know, we can have balance between top down. No, sorry, bottom up, and then organize it all together. Also, if someone use Polyglot Indonesia brand to do something harmful, we can shoot them because we have the legal people as well. Right, that's another things that we want as well. Yes.
Remember, if you ask a question, you get a free pin.
Oh yeah. Sorry. So, what's your name and what pin do you want?
Richard.
Yeah. Richard Russian. Okay, interesting. Richard Russian. Yes.
So, hi there. So my question is.
Your name, please.
Vedran.
Vedran. And do you want a pin?
Yeah. Sure. Sure. Let's say Chinese.
Chinese, okay.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. So my question is related to the previous one, really. Like, how do you find sponsors, and who are typically your sponsors? Mm. Like, which organizations, like language product companies, or yeah.
Yeah, that's a good question as well. Sponsor, we actually still trying to manage the sponsor because it took like 2 years to get the legal entity. To be a legal entity in Indonesia, so it takes so long. So we are we have a marketing team, and then we have a fundraiser team that actually brainstorming how we can get a sponsor. But we are aiming for NGO I don't know if I can say name, but like NGO from different countries, and then we are selling merchandise as well. We have this and then this. Oh yeah. We are actually, we have a lot of this. It's €1 each, if you want to support us, basically. That's one thing. And then we have, we help companies to find language learners as well. So one of the big brands contact us, can you find interpreter in this particular language? So, and then we have job listing as well that we will create. And we have an e-commerce site that we have as well. So that kind of revenue stream that we have. But until now, it's solely based on personal money. And to pay for the hosting, the websites, and everything. And we try to bootstrap ourselves. So for instance, when we have an event, we sell this merchandise, and we hope we get some profits. And then we can have that for our operation. So to answer your question really quick, we sell stuff. Ha 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 ha!